does it. Read the screen, right? No, because if I put too much, these people might not see that. These people might not see the presentation.
It's a good thing you aren't coming back.
How is it now? It's good? Okay. One, two, one, two, one, two, one, two, one, two, one, two, one, two. One, two, one, two, one, two. see you go to the film room from there?
Yeah.
So it's good if you have it here.
Okay, you got it. Great. That clementine smells so good, doesn't it?
Yes, you too.
Did Jane get to play with the clicker?
Let's see.
Boss, you are a marvel. Cool.
That's good.
Yeah. Oh. All
right.
Yay.
That was fantastic. You're the perfect place for it.
Thank you. Is good?
You see, so you got this. I mean, it is what it is. I mean, you could cheat this a little bit this way. How's it?
Thank you.
Welcome, everyone, to this evening's gathering. I'm Serene Jones, and I'm the president here at Union. I think I have the most amazing job in the world to get to be at a place like this and to be a part of these conversations. This afternoon, I had what for me was a sort of a dream-like, hope-filled experience. When we think about the earth and the sounds and the furious pace and the destruction and what is raining down on us and what is coming up around us, I was sitting in my office doing emails, and about every 30 minutes, I was showered with the sound of applause coming from your gathering. And that was very moving, actually, in terms of signs of hope, of people gathering and daring to put together imagination and training and backgrounds and commitments and personal lives, and to put them into a rich stew out of which, by necessity, we will together pull our future. That's what this whole Insight project is about, and this is the, as you know, first colloquium that we've done. I'm very thankful to John. Here he is known only as John T. Sometimes the jaunty fellow, but no, John Tatamanal and all the work he's put into this. Also, a word of thanks to Mary Coelho for making this possible, and for a very wonderful, committed, long life of involvement in these issues. Mary, thank you. And a special thanks, too, to Jane Bennett for being here and for your Walt Whitman solar judgment. I'm sorry I can't stay. I have to go to another event. I was just telling Jane I just wrote a book, and the subtitle of the book is Finding Meaning in a Fractured World. And someone was typing to me a note very quickly the other day, and they said, I love your book, Call It Grace, and it said, Funding Meaning in a Fractured World. And I thought, yes, that's what I do. I fund meaning in a fractured world. But also just a warm word of welcome to the students who are here, to the visitors who are here, to people who have come from far and near, and to the theological minds, some of you dear friends that I haven't seen for a while. It's wonderful to have you in this place and in this space in New York, in Manhattan, in New York City, in New York State, in the United States, in North America, in this small spot on the planet, in the big, huge cosmos in which we find ourselves and are called together to do the work of breathing together and figuring out together what justice looks like anew. And as we learn to experience mercy in new ways that are empowering and transformative for how we imagine, and finally in places where love is allowed to expand and change us as we open ourselves to it. So have a wonderful evening, and I know the conversation continues tomorrow, and I'm sure it will be wonderful, and good things will come of this. So it's my pleasure to now ask John Tatamanal to come forward and introduce our evening. Thank you, John.
Thank you, Serene. Oh, she already dashed? So, well, that was a fast exit indeed. Yes, she's off to fund a meaning in a fractured world, so I'm glad she does that indeed. So, I'm John Tatamanal. I direct the Insight Project here, a project made possible by Mary Coelho. And I too extend my thanks for this wonderful opportunity. I it has now become customary for us to begin our time together by remembering that we gather on the lands of the Lenape people. As we ponder collectively our obligation to care for the earth, we would do well to remember also the unfinished work of repair and reconciliation with First Nations communities who have issued to us the call to be caretakers of the earth. The Insight Project, which Mary has generously funded here, is a multi-year program series that seeks to put theology in conversation with a wide range of partners in the humanities, social sciences, and the natural sciences. When Mary and I were talking about designing this program, one of the crucial elements she wanted was not just the public events like this one, but that the life of Union Theological Seminary and the classes here and the students here would be transformed by the conversations that are happening. So that's why we started a class that would go with the theme of every year. So this marks towards the tail end of a class on theology in the natural world. Next year we'll do a course also in the spring semester. Tentatively we're calling that The Feeling Animal, and the subtitle is Theology, Feeling, Affect Theory, Practice, and Theology. Thinking about not only the fact that we're not merely rational animals in a reductive enlightenment sense, but that if we are feeling animals, then we have to take responsibility for those feelings by means of disciplines and practices. So hence the attention to practice also. So that's what we're going to be doing next year, and through that process, we'll continue the conversation. One component of this entire process has also been the colloquium that we are running this weekend, where we're gathering a number of people who have already contributed to conversations on theology in the natural world in very important and meaningful ways. And our students are getting to spend time with some of these remarkable and courageous intellects. So we're grateful for the folks who are here. Would the folks who are speakers this weekend please just raise their hands so people know? And if all goes according to plan, we will produce a book emerging from just these voices and a few others. So you'll not only get to hear them now, but you'll get to take something with you, hopefully, in the not too distant future. Now, I'd like to invite, introduce our respondent and our speaker, and I'll do that in the reverse order. First, I'll say a word about Mark Wallace. Mark Wallace is professor of religion at Swarthmore College. His teaching and research interests focus on the intersections between Christian theology, critical theory, environmental studies, and postmodernism. He is the author of Green Christianity, Finding God in the Singing River, Fragments of the Spirit, Nature, Violence, and the Renewal of Creation, and in an earlier incarnation as a Ricoeur scholar, The Second Naivete, Barthes, Ricoeur, and the New Yale Theology. His most recently completed new book, I haven't even had a chance to get going in it, is just breathtaking even in its title, When God Was a Bird, Christianity, Animism, and the Reenchantment of the World, a theme that is quite at the heart of our speaker's work, too. So I think there should be a lively conversation between the two. In addition to all that Mark does academically, he's also an activist and one who does his work at some considerable personal expense, not merely in places safely removed from his place of work, but precisely at Swarthmore, trying to work at his college on disinvesting the college from fossil fuels. And this kind of thing, when you do it in your own home institution, is never without cost. So we owe Mark a great deal, not only for his intellectual work, but for all that he does on his feet as well. So welcome, Mark. Now to a few words about Jane Bennett, about whom actually books have been written. So it would not be good for this evening if I were to proceed at that length, so I will try to keep it brief so we can actually hear from her. Jane Bennett is Andrew Mellon Professor of the Humanities at Johns Hopkins, where she serves in the Department of Political Science, which she has in the past chaired. She is regarded as a key voice in a philosophical movement called the New Materialism. I don't think she ever called that that movement by that name. Yes, yes, that's right. That, by the way, is the critique often made of the New Materialists, that the movement should never have been called new. So, she's the author of many books, including The Enchantment of Modern Life, Attachments, Crossings, and Ethics, Thoreau's Nature, Ethics, Politics, and the Wild, Unthinking Faith and Enlightenment, Nature and the State in a Post-Hegelian Era. In our class this semester, we read her latest published book, Vibrant Matter, A Political Ecology of Things, and we are particularly keen for her forthcoming book, due out next year, entitled Influx and Efflux, Writing Up with Walt Whitman. I think every book that is published next year will claim to have 2020 vision. So, bad joke, sorry. So much more could be said about her beyond the titles of her books and her academic distinctions. I will just add that she seems to have recently taken to spending time with theological types. Most recently with Catherine Keller and friends at Drew's Transdisciplinary Theological Colloquium. And as a part of that work, she contributed an important essay into a volume that came out of that conference entitled Vegetal Life and Ontosympathy. Her making kin with theological critters, if I can channel Donna Haraway, seems to have rubbed off on her. Consider how she concludes her book, Vibrant Matter. She concludes with a theological creed of her own, and it's beautiful, so I'll, by way of introduction, read just this part. She writes, "So I will end with a litany, a kind of Nicene creed for would-be vital materialist. I believe in one matter energy, the maker of things seen and unseen. I believe that this pluriverse is traversed by heterogeneities that are continually doing things. I believe it is wrong to deny vitality to non-human bodies, forces, and forms, and that a careful course of anthropomorphization can help reveal that vitality, even though it resists full translation and exceeds my comprehensive grasp. I believe that encounters with lively matter can chasten my fantasies of human mastery, highlight the common materiality of all that is, expose a wider distribution of agency, and reshape the self and its interests." You know, I think that would actually preach. So, to the sermon then. Let's welcome Dr. Jane Bennett.
Thank you. That was a lovely introduction. Thanks, everybody, for coming tonight. Thank you, John, Tom, and Neil, for inviting me. Thanks for your impressive, the presentations by the impressive and pressing students. Thanks to the other presenters who I will hear from tomorrow. And thank you in advance to the commentator. Thank you, Mark. Okay. Leaves of Grass, book of poems that Whitman wrote and rewrote for about 30 years. He kept just adding poems, moving them around, reassembling it. The first edition came out in 1855, and he wrote a preface to it, which is sort of stands on its own even as the later editions came out, because the preface is fantastic there from 1855. And in that preface, and then he repeats these lines again in one of his poems called By Blue Ontario Shore, Whitman attributes to the poet, and all people can be poets, this very impressive skill, and the skill is this. The poet has learned how to judge, quote, not as the judge judges, but as the sun falling round a helpless thing, end quote. And here is the passage. So I'll just let you read it for a sec. Okay. Okay, so the first time I read that line, to judge as the sun, not as the judge judges, but as the sun falling around a helpless thing, it was, I couldn't get it out of my head. I kept thinking, what could that mean? What could it mean to do that? And why would someone want to try? Why on some occasions would you work to eschew disputes and practice silence? And how is that to see the farthest? And what is this strange temporal space that has no prologue or denouement? So my talk this evening is just going to really be a reflection on that passage. I'm going to take up those questions. Okay, first, part one, going solar. And that's around the line, again, judge not as the judge judges, but as the sun falling around a helpless thing. So let's sort of, for a moment, ignore the word judge, and let's elide any thought about what is a proper theory of judgment or a critique of judgment in a kind of Kantian framework, which in my world is where people, the political theory world, will swarm right in on that. But let's just push that off for a bit in order to attend to Whitman's call to act like the sun. Okay, so I do a little Wikipedia thing. What is the sun? Okay, the sun is, quote, a yellow dwarf star, a hot ball of glowing gases that holds the solar system together, keeping everything from the biggest planets to the smallest particles of debris in its orbit. Electric currents in the sun generate a magnetic field that is carried out throughout the solar system by the solar wind, which is a stream of electrically charged gas blowing outward from the sun in all directions. Okay, so that's the backstory, and now I gotta try to think about me and you acting like that. The poet is to fall round like the sun, which is obviously a very tall order for a small, short-lived terrestrial body, like a human being. It may be helpful, I think, to visualize what would be the human posture of such solarity. What is this stance of falling round that lights up and holds things together by way of an electrically charged wind? Maybe it looks like these. The first one is, the last one is, you know, Da Vinci's famous Vitruvian Man. This is a female version of it, and that is my own artwork version of the stance of this, of falling round. Now, I think it's funny, but it also makes a difference to assume the stance of the of the disposition that you want to enact or you want to inhabit, because there's a really close connection between position and disposition, or posture and mood, let us say. So such a radiating stance, open-armed, palms out, it helps to induce, as it may also express, a disposition that is accepting of things, that is as accepting of things as nature is of the poet. And Whitman reminds us in a parenthesis from that earlier, the passage, nature accepts the poet absolutely. So to go solar, then, might be to call forth from one's flesh a moment of elemental Catholicity, and other orientedness free of, yeah, I was a Catholic, that's why I can't even pronounce it now, and other orientedness free of ignominious distinctions, a receptivity to whatever or whoever you are. I'm now quoting from Whitman, and here's one of the lists that he has in the poems. They're full of lists. A receptivity to whatever or whoever you are, exclamation point, enslaved man or woman, farmer's wife, workman, son or daughter of China, Slavic Empire, Damascus, Rome, Naples, Persia, Greece, prisoner, helpless infant or old person, tires of carts, boot soles, horses, snow sleighs, roused mobs, stones. So to go solar would be, perhaps, to inhabit a moment of unalloyed impartiality, to acknowledge presences without ranking them, to hear testimonies from people, places, and things without preference. Solarity would be, then, a radically ecumenical praise. And again, from the passage, his thoughts, the poet's thoughts, would be the hymns of the praise of things. Now, this expansive solarity is not quite the same as love, even if the passage from By Blue Ontario's Shore, this one, even if that passage does resonate with Jesus' injunction to judge not, as in this passage from Luke. But I say unto you who are listening, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, be compassionate as your Father is compassionate. Do not judge and you will not be judged yourselves. Do not condemn and you will not be condemned yourselves. Grant pardon and you will be pardoned. Now, Whitman seems to be tilting the interpersonal divine relationality that is Christian love toward, and I probably have an unsophisticated understanding of that, so I'm waiting for more. He seems to be tilted the interpersonal divine relationality that is Christian love toward a more cosmic, apersonal, and self-dispersing solar fall, a kind of atmospheric dissemination. Solarity as a kind of generic curiosity or anexact perusing lacks the depth psychology often associated with the word love. Like the earth, the character earth in another of Whitman's poems called Song of the Rolling Earth, and what she does, earth does, is, quote, glance as she sits, inviting none, denying none. Like that earth, the solar poet not only plays no favorites, but is moved by an attraction to things that is less emotional than maybe gravitational. Its wellspring is not a shared divine patrimony, as when Whitman, the young journalist, had called his readers to, quote, forget not that the same God who made us made them, and that his sunshine and blessings come alike to them as to us. He's arguing against the death penalty there. So the wellspring of this other kind of solar judgment, I'm calling it, it's not a shared divine patrimony, as in that quotation, but it's more like a common physics, even in astrophysics. So to go solar, I say, or I propose, to judge not as the judge judges is also, says Whitman, to see the farthest. The poet, standing by the shore of Lake Ontario, gazes way, way off into the distance and the future in a looking that goes over the edge of what the human eye can normally register. What then starts to appear is not a landscape dotted with discrete entities, the passage said, you know, he doesn't see women as dots, men and women as dots. So what happens when you sort of see the farthest, what starts to appear is not a landscape dotted with discrete entities, but an iterative eternity, an ongoing process that Whitman elsewhere describes as, quote, the endless finale of things. The effort of Whitman's poet is to call forth from its electric body a bright beam of light. And here's another quote from the poem. I find I incorporate gneiss, coal, long-threaded moss, fruits, grains, esculent roots, and now we might add to that line, sunlight. The poet does not so much imitate sunlight's fall as tap a sunny apersonality already afloat in and through one. Okay. All right, now let's move more to this notion of judge. And this section is called discrimination or influence. Okay, I'll repeat the phrase, judge not as the judge judges, but as the sun falling round a helpless thing. Let's turn to the word judge and to this peculiarly solar kind of judging. How could an uncritical falling of light and an electrically charged gas possibly qualify as judgment? Is not discrimination the very essence of judgment? An excellent Whitman scholar named Ed Folsom has suggested that what Whitman is doing in that passage is, quote, developing a new edge to the word discrimination, a word that was undergoing important changes in connotation in the second half of the 19th century. It was shifting meaning simply from meaning the making of a distinction to suggesting something significantly more sinister in a democratic society, where the very act of making distinctions in respect to quality, of setting up hierarchies of value, came to be perceived as an anti-democratic process that discriminated against those who did not share decision-making authority. That's all a quote from Folsom. Now, I think Folsom is right. That's what Whitman's trying to do here, is sort of re-signify discrimination away from just a kind of neutral difference noting to a kind of discriminatory practice. But what I would add is this. What enables Whitman to develop this new edge to the word discrimination is his propensity to accent process over result. For Whitman, judging, like any human act, partakes in an always underdetermined process of sort of influx and efflux. Influences coming in, being digested, and then being expressed out. Judging, Whitman reminds us, is irreducible to the categorical distinctions social distinctions and juridical decisions asserted or invoked, for the condition of possibility of all such determinations is to have already been susceptible to a powerful set of inflows or influences, some societal and some more than not. Okay. Influence. Let's just think a little bit about influence. It's a word that you'll hear a lot once you start paying attention to it, because it's a really powerful word. It's a way of denoting modes of difference making, but those modes of difference making don't quite fit the category of causal, right? So people often talk about influence. Influence is a tendency for outsides to ooze, drift, seep, incur across the perimeter of insides. The propensity to cross over an edge, to cause to flow in, to infuse, inspire, instill as emanation from the stars or the inflow of water. That's a combination of my own definition in Oxford English Dictionary. Even after the judge has rejected or pushed aside influences in order to pronounce a decision, the influences will have already made an impression. They will have had the strange efficacy of what Alfred North Whitehead calls negative prehensions, a topic to which I will briefly return. Within the process philosophies of Whitman and Whitehead, which sees first the forest and then the trees, first the morphing milieu and then the decision, a decision is not the apex of judgment, but a temporary, albeit useful, blockage of its course. To judge as the sun falling round is to take a time out from the effort of rank ordering and to trade the pleasure of closure for the pleasure of float. The poet, quote, is no arguer. He is judgment. Or perhaps here a middle voiced formulation would be better. I be judgment. Sort of neither object nor subject. To judge as the judge judges is to dote on the dot time of decision. But to judge as the sun falling round is to hover in the interval between influence and decision, between taking note and pronouncing a verdict, between shedding light and seeing the light. Okay, part three is called the interval. So I want to say a little bit more about this hovering in the interval. Think of this interval as an existential given, a perceptual float, rather than something that the poet or the judge inserts or installs. It is a spontaneous phase of hovering prior to and preliminary to the taking on of any identifiable thought, claim, or comportment. And here's the poet, she's also a classicist, Anne Carson, in a book called Float. Here's what she says about this. Right? One or two beats before a thought forms itself into anything like mental speech, into a phrase or a sentence, into an order of communication, something earlier, rougher, more gripped, more frail, more saturated exists, something that, compared to a sentence, is still wild. This wild interval, which all of us are experiencing at a very subtle level, is ubiquitous, and yet it's almost too subtle to feel. It's very, very lightly experienced, but it's not nothing. It is the precursor to the more overt comportment that Whitman names as nonchalance. Whitman spins nonchalance as a democratic disposition appropriate for citizens who have cultivated the ability to keep cool and non-defensive in the face of social diversity. Nonchalance, he says, enacts an effective detour around a response of fear or antagonism. Nonchalance interferes with the slide from the exposure to difference to a feeling of affront. If nonchalance is a deliberate practice, a democratic virtue pursued with conscious effort, and that's a long story which I haven't really given you here, solarity is an apersonal perceptual hover out of which you may grow your virtue of nonchalance to the extent that you think that's a virtue. The interval is the float within experience. Here's what Whitman says in another poem. There's something there is in the float of the sight of things. Something there is in the float of the sight of things. The interval is also what he calls the measureless float out of which an I, the letter I, out of which an I bubbles up, as in this poem called As I Ebbed with the Ocean of Life. It's the diffuse float antecedent to any intentional effort, And it's as apparent in the balanced motionless of these eagles. And here's another is a passage. Four wings, gigantic, two beaks, downward gyrating, splendid, swift loops, over and over, turning, revolving, circling, falling, close to the river, pausing, balanced, motionless. That's the interval. Or think of the solar interval that you and I inhabit as the limen, or the threshold, described by the anthropologist Victor Turner. Here's what he writes. An interval, however brief, when the past is momentarily negated, suspended, or abrogated, and the future has not yet begun, an instant of pure potentiality when everything, as it were, trembles in the balance. Or the interval is something like what Thoreau says when he writes in his journal, poetry puts an interval between the impression and the expression, waits till the seed germinates naturally. Right, so poetry, I like that passage, because poetry is not the expression. Poetry is the inhabitation of the float that puts a pause between what you're taking in and what you're putting out. Okay. Poetry buys time for unspoken influences and percepts to ferment. Okay, let me take a little philosophical detour now to this section's called Prehension and Effective Tone. Okay, this interval I'm talking about that I think is involved in Whitman's poetry there, it's wild, vague, non-conscious, but not, says Whitehead, wholly unfelt. The interval is a phase of what Whitehead calls prehension, or that recursive movement of influx and efflux by which experience is produced. Whitehead distinguishes between prehensions that, quote, make a positive contribution to the subject's own real internal constitution, and those prehensions that are negative prehensions or flash impressions of ingressions that are received but then immediately rejected or screened out. So right at the moment, both those things are going on. For Whitehead, as for Henri Bergson, experience is necessarily subtractive. Not noticing some things is a condition of noticing anything at all. But Whitehead insists that even negative prehensions inflect the character of experience. Even those things that came in and your perceptual system rejected them out, they too struck a faint tone that made a difference to your subjectivity and to your feeling. Okay? Negative prehensions have their own subjective forms which they contribute to the process. A feeling bears on itself the scars of its birth. It recollects its struggle for existence. It retains the impress of what it might have been but is not. Okay, so Whitehead is keen to acknowledge the fact that not all contributions to prehensions are felt by us with the same degree of overtness, specificity, or weight. Some inflows register as discrete ideas and words, some as vivid or fleeting images, some as bodily emotions or moods, and many, many, many more as float or interval or as influences that affect us in an exceedingly delicate, ethereal manner. These diaphanous forces register as what Whitehead calls affective tone. Striking it makes a difference, it affects, but it's not felt as an emotion. Striking a tone is how very, very subtle influences make a difference to human experience. Whitehead's concept of affective tone helps me to better understand what is happening as the judge judges as the sun judges, as the sun falling round. Well, Whitman's poetry is famously sensuous. It highlights erotic and other passion-infused feelings. I have instant conductors all over me, whether I pass or stop, they seize every object and lead it harmlessly through me, he says. Whitehead, however, warns against restricting the avenues of communication with the external world to the five sense organs. A second error, says Whitehead, is the presupposition that the sole way of examining experience is by acts of conscious introspective analysis. But Whitman's not guilty of that. But he is guilty of trying to basically restrict experience to stuff that comes in through the senses. And then Whitehead invents this whole vocabulary for naming things that make a difference and strike a tone, but are both below cognitive radar and also below the radars of the senses. Okay. Affective tone is not sensed, says Whitehead, for it, quote, depends mainly on the condition of the viscera, which are peculiarly ineffective in generating sensations. We prehend other actual entities more primitively by tone, and only secondarily and waveringly by sense, end quote. Sense perception and conscious thought, says Whitehead, tap only a very few dimensions of experience. Conscious discrimination is a variable factor only present in the more elaborate examples of occasions of experience. On the fringe of consciousness, and yet massively qualifying our experience, is a vast background and foreground of non-sensuous perception with which sense perception is fused and without which it can never be. It carries an effective tone that, quote, has the vagueness of the low hum of insects in an August woodland. That's like the only poetic sentence in Process and Reality. As an example of the physiology of effective tone, we might turn to recent studies of olfactory receptors in and on the human body. This I learned from, you know, the Science Times section of the New York Times. Every millisecond, you and I are receiving an influx of countless odor molecules that do not reach the threshold of smell. Our skin and our internal organs, and not only our noses, bristle with olfactory receptors, specialized chemical detectors on the surface of cells that sense, ingest, and alter themselves in response to their odor molecule counterparts. I'm still quoting from this article, the Science writer. Think of olfactory receptors as a lock and key system with an odor molecule, the key to the receptor's lock. Only certain molecules fit with the certain receptors. When the right molecule comes along and alights on the matching receptor, it sets in motion an elaborate choreography of biochemical reactions. One study shows that exposing olfactory receptors to a sandalwood odor sets off a cascade of molecular signals that appears to induce healing in injured tissue. Another study shows that a primary odor compound in violets and roses appeared to inhibit the spread of prostate cancer cells by switching off errant genes. And a third study showed that the fragrance redolent of lily of the valley promoted the regeneration of muscle tissue. So, yeah, this is good news for aromatherapy, but it's also a kind of slightly more concrete example of what it might mean to say that we are being affected by things that below the radar of cognition and sensuousness. Okay, let me turn now to judges and the practice of making decisions. This section is called Ethos Without the Application of Morals. That's what Whitman is after. He wants to create an ethos, but he doesn't want the application of morals. All right. The moral philosopher Martha Nussbaum has also paid attention to the very same lines that have provoked me about judging like the sun. And she, too, acknowledges that judging is a process. But compared to the reading I've just offered, her reading tends to reduce Whitman's enigmatic call to fall like sunlight to a more common sense kind of adage. The adage is best not to rush to judgment, best to make a verdict based on careful consideration of all the relevant evidence. Now, what Nussbaum does is translates the call to judge as the sun falling into a kind of sentencing guideline. Judges should first examine every curve, I'm quoting her, every curve, every nook, and every qualitative difference, and all the historical and human complexities of the particular case before they make a decision. Nussbaum's theory of judgment prioritizes the moment of decision, a decision positioned as the culmination of a process that is a means to it. The difference between my reading and Nussbaum's is the difference between a call to hover in the interval between impression and expression, because the hover reveals the ontological multiplicity of an I, that's what I was trying to say, and a call for a moral subject to take her time with the evidence in order to make a better decision. So I'll read that again. The difference between my reading and Nussbaum's is the difference between, on the one hand, a call to hover in the interval between impression and expression, because the hover reveals the ontological multiplicity of an I, meaning that that the moral subject is many, many things besides a moral subject, and that's the one, and a call for a moral subject to take her time with the evidence in order to make a better decision. And indeed, I think Nussbaum does an excellent job of identifying how leaves of grass might contribute to a more humane, less coldly rationalistic practice of jurisprudence. But I think Nussbaum misses the more radically sort of new materialist implications of the sun-human encounter that's affirmed in the poem. She misses Whitman's effort to learn how to inhabit more richly a cosmic strata of human experience. He calls it cosmic. The interval accompanying every perception does make possible the practice of liberal impartiality, but it's also the moment when gravitational sympathies can strike a more resonant tone in human bodies. Like the feeling of your, there's another great line that I love of Whitman's, which he says, the press of my foot to the ground springs 100 affections. It's just like the ordinary act of taking a step and being subject to gravity. There's this affective tone of affection, right? So Nussbaum misses Whitman's effort to learn how to inhabit more richly a cosmic strata of human experience. The interval accompanying every perception does make possible the practice of liberal impartiality, but it's also the moment when gravitational sympathies might strike a more resonant tone in human bodies. Nussbaum's ideal self is a composed moral agent oriented toward making careful, deliberative decisions. Not against that. It's just that... That's quite a different shape than the kind of I, the letter I, that Whitman, I think, is trying to induce for a moment in his readers. And it's an I that he describes as the partaker of influx and efflux. The line is, partaker of influx and efflux, comma, I. Nussbaum's judge seeks more complete information. The solar poet, I am saying, valorizes moments when thought and feeling are in suspense, and an ahuman echelon of existence edges towards the foreground of perception. Nussbaum's judge, a moral subject in a world of objects, does not inhabit a world of vibrant matter. Nussbaum can't really imagine a judgment outside of a juridical frame of moral rankings. Whitman clearly can, and his poems will dote on a responsiveness that, quote, makes no discriminations and is done with reviews and criticisms. Such solarity is surely a dangerous game insofar as the sun falls equally upon deadly viruses, torture equipment, slaveholders, Donald Trump, and other nasty creatures, and not only on lovely, enriching, vital, or helpless things. But Whitman seems to think that the practice of solarity is worth that risk, perhaps because a sense of cosmic connectedness is so fragile, whereas the veridical reflex and its judgmental pleasures are so strong. There's no danger that the pleasure in judging is going to go away, or is going to stop us from making judgments. Prolonged suspension of normative categories and discriminating perception is incompatible, if it's prolonged, with social order, justice, and sanity. But the practice of loafing in the interval remains a valuable element within democracy, he insists. For one thing, it sets a condition for the emergence of new voices, claims, or rights that have not yet settled into the sensibility of the judicious man or woman. For another, it helps to fold some nonchalance into the disposition of encounter. In other words, solarity is one important element of Whitman's ethos. And ethos is the operative word here. For there's no doubt that when Whitman judges, in the normal sense of that word, the practice of solarity to be good. Solarity is good. It's good to judge like falling sun. It's a valuable element within the broader public ethos that he espouses in Leaves of Grass. This public culture clearly is to lean democratic. It's supposed to celebrate egalitarianism. It's very partial to sympathy and affection for the earth. It esteems people who are plucky but generous beyond all models. I'm just selectively quoting from the various poems. And he likes people who are egalitarian, free of despair or misanthropy or cunning or exclusiveness or the ignominy of nativity or color or delusion of hell. Whitman, moreover, clearly ranks pluralism above dogmatism, a project that many political theorists and many people today continue to pursue. He thinks it's better to refrain from theological disputes than to engage in them, to practice nonchalance when it comes to ultimate religious values. Here's a quote. Did you suppose that there could only be one supreme? We affirm that there cannot be one supreme, but unnumbered supremes, that the one does not countervail another any more than one eyesight countervails another, end quote. And in the preface to the 1855 edition, Whitman lays it all out, his normative ethos, in a civic riff on Jesus. And you probably, I don't know if this is well known but it to you, but this is what you should do. Love the earth and the sun and the animals. Despise riches. Give alms to everyone that asks. Stand up for the stupid and crazy. Devote your income and labor to others. Hate tyrants. Argue not concerning God. Have patience and indulgence towards the people. Take off your hat to nothing known or unknown or any number of men. Go freely with powerful, uneducated persons and the young and with the mothers of families. Read these leaves in the open air every season of your life. A little self-promotion there. Re-examine all you have been, leaves of grass is the leaves you're supposed to be reading. Re-examine all you have been told at school or church. Dismiss whatever insults your own soul. And your very flesh shall be a great poem and have the richest fluency, not only in its words, but in the silent lines of its lips and face, and between the lashes of your eyes and in every motion and joint of your body. All this brings us to the question of how the overt normativity of Whitman's writings coexists alongside his eschewal, even his disdain for judging like the judge judges. He tries to square this circle with a practice of valuation that avoids what he calls the application of morals. So he's drawing a distinction, rough distinction between ethos and morals. He says the greatest poet does not moralize or make application of morals. And that comes right after this passage. But what does that mean? What does moralizing entail for Whitman such that his public ethos is not an application of morals? Is he calling for a situational ethics in lieu of an absolutist morality? Nussbaum highlights how this is indeed part of his project. But I think that Whitman is also calling us to consider a less familiar possibility, that what ought to make us pause about moralizing or what today might be called calling out, is its tendency to colonize human sensibility such that too wide a swath of experience becomes subjected automatically to the ranking operation called judgment. Now, it's crucial to be able to distinguish between harmful and healthy, bad and good, painful and pleasurable, right and wrong, but morality, the application of morals, tends not only to be too confident about where those lines are to be drawn, it tends also to overestimate, Whitman says, the size of the sphere in which it is appropriate to prehend by hierarchizing. Whitman suggests instead, one, that there's a large share of actions and events that do not need that kind of judgment and for which the application of morals is inappropriate. And two, that the overextension of moral judgment has produced a lot of unnecessary exploitation, social conflict, hostility, distrust, ill will, and harm. Now, if in the history of Western philosophy, morality is often figured as a disciplined check on a tendency towards excess intrinsic to the passions or appetites, Whitman uncovers a propensity for excess within the application of morals. That's why it's so important to affirm with a light touch, he says, to strike a tone of suggestiveness. Quote, the word I myself put primarily for the description of leaves of grass is suggestiveness. And in a journal, like his notebook to himself, he writes this. It's like a note to himself. In writing, apply the same taste and law as in personal demeanor. That is, never to strain or exhibit the least apparent desire to make stick out the pride, grandeur, and boundless richness, but to be those and let the spirit of them vitalize whatever is said. Okay. In short, morality is for him judgment happy, and as a result, trigger happy. Moralists too often and too quickly look for a fight, especially in a pluralistic society with diverse normative commitments and moral sources. The effect of moral appeals can be more to offend and antagonize, just at a strategic, pragmatic level, he says, than to elevate and ameliorate. Okay. Whitman suggests this. Before entering the agon of contesting morality, see first if nonchalance may apply. When an idea or practice or persona insults your own soul, see if it is possible and wise to dismiss it in order to redirect your finite energies to these tasks. Quote, love the earth and the sun and the animals, despise riches, give alms to everyone who asks, stands up for the stupid and crazy, devote your income and labor to others, hate tyrants, argue not concerning God. For Whitman, this is my last paragraph, to judge as the judge judges is to inculcate into oneself a particular regime of perception. This regime is highly sensitive to the presence of differences, and it receives them as items to be ranked. Whitman calls his audience to improve instead another set of detection possibilities or skills. He calls us to improve our detection of sympathetic currents between bodies that share a common pool of atoms. Here's another line. Every atom belonging to me as good belongs to you. End quote. To enhance detection of such inexact and invisible flows will produce new blind spots, in particular what today we will call the operation of unconscious racial bias. But if the application of morals is good at lighting up veridical hierarchies of white privilege, heteronormativity, anthropocentrism, leaves of grass is good at exposing the possibility of a world where everybody, quote, always vibrating with living and buried speech, might stand abreast. There's no doubt at all that there are times when rage and war and moral examination are what is needed most, but one can also, alongside that recognition, I think, appreciate Whitman's call to see the undersides of righteous militants. Hone also the skill of judging not as the judge judges, but as the sun falling round a helpless thing. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I want to make sure you can hear me. Are you able to hear me? Okay, wonderful. When I first encountered Jane's book, Vibrant Matter, I felt like I was entering a universe that I had long lived in, but no one had given me the language to express the kind of world that I had always already inhabited, but didn't quite have the right vocabulary to describe it. In the book, she obliterates human chauvinism in terms of the tendency we have to arrogate to ourselves as human beings, supreme value over all other beings. And she does it by a way of discussing how all beings or all things, all entities, everything that is, participates in the capacity to be in relationship with other beings, to be active, to be a bearer of a certain kind of individuality and personality. And so I'm very grateful for your work in that book, in this paper, and now other things that I've read that you've done. It embodies Jane's work and others, this new philosophical movement, albeit an ancient philosophical movement, called Vibrant Matter or New Materialism. And in this book, she privileges the idea of solarity, the idea that there is a dynamic identified with the sun, which she affectionately calls the yellow dwarf star, that the sun disseminates its current in such a way that can model for us how we are to relate ourselves to others. She talks about the importance of floating or loafing or hovering between the posture in which we are passive and not impacted by others, and the posture by which we are forward-facing and making decisions and highly active in the judgments that we make. In between those two postures, in between what she calls, on the one hand, impression, and on the other hand, expression, is a third state, That's difficult to name. It's interstitial. It's a kind of hybrid. It's what she calls in her paper, citing Victor Turner, a liminal state. Limen being the Latin word for a threshold. Let me give a couple of examples of this, one very personal and one more abstract and philosophical. My wife, Audrey, is here tonight. And one of the joys that we have now begun to experience in this time of year in the house that we live on, on the edge of a once great forest outside Philadelphia called the Crum Woods. Crum, the Swedish word for crooked, C-R-U-M. Is at this time of year, spring peepers appear in the forest. And unless you're embedded in the forest like we are, this is an incredible gift that we've been able to enjoy. You don't hear the peepers' mad peeping that goes on all through the night. Tiny frogs, tens of thousands of which overcome their winter doldrums and their winter slumbers, maybe the size of a dime, in a mad, passionate embrace with one another, the erotics of the planet sing their mad peeping song all through the night in waves and waves of exuberant joy and passion. When Alfred North Whitehead departs from his typical sort of philosophical prose into poetry, and talks about this experience that Jane talked about as, quote, the low hum of insects. That's what Audrey and I experience in the woods this time of year. Not insects in this case, but peeper frogs. As we drift into sleep, we're not quite asleep, but we're also not in an active, decisionist, judgmental mode. We're not purely passive, and we're not purely active. And in this in-between space, the sound of the peepers rises into the woods and keeps us afloat and adrift, and sometimes awake throughout the night. A more philosophical version of this, Emmanuel Levinas, the Lithuanian Jewish philosopher, wrote in the 20th century about what he called preconscious states of being, where we are enabled to encounter others in all of their individuality and in their humanity and in their vulnerability, precisely at those times when we're not passively asleep or distant or disconnected, and in those times when we're not actively, consciously discriminating and judging. Mixing Levinas and Whitehead here, we could call this the preconscious prehension of the irreducible being of others in all of their vulnerability, as they light up in our consciousness that's not quite consciousness. At times he said that, like Audrey and myself in the woods with the spring peepers, at times that he says are like just that moment, early in the morning, when you're not quite awake, but you're no longer asleep. And in the distance, you hear something come into your consciousness, something unique and distinctive that is impressing or ingressing you, but that you don't control, that you don't have sovereignty over. In Levinas's case, it's the face of the other person. And we could expand that to the face of all others. And it's that experience of not apprehending, nor simply being passively impacted by, but in this interstitial moment, receiving the impression of the other, that I think is at the heart of Jane's notion of solarity and her rehabilitation of Whitman. If that's the case, let me offer a friendly critique of this way of thinking. I do think that ethics, like with Jane Bennett and Emmanuel Levinas, I do think that ethics emerges from this place. I think how we comport ourselves to others, how we live, the decisions that we make, come out of this space, a space that we should cultivate and nurture in ourselves and others, in which in this space we are called to live in harmony and in solidarity with others. But I don't think of this space is as, if I could put it this way, and I offer this as a kind of friendly critique, I don't think of this space as bloodless or emotionless or dispassionate. Jane talks about the importance of an apersonal and gravitational space, and I'm suggesting that that interstitial space, listening to the peepers, hearing the voice of the other, that that space is intensely personalist and intensely emotional as well. Recent work in affect theory, I think, moves in this direction. What I think we feel in those moments, not purely passive, not purely active moments, is something like the personhood of all beings. Is something like what recently in Evo Morales' Bolivia in 2010 promulgated a document about the Universal Declaration of the Rights of Mother Earth, in which the declaration opens up the possibility of all beings as living beings participating together in a common family with a common destiny. I don't experience the peepers as impersonal. I don't experience the peepers dispassionately. I don't experience the peepers as, and one of the phrases Jane uses in her larger paper, with a kind of calm, cool, and nonchalance. But I do experience them in this kind of strange, loafing, hovering, floating moment. I think what I'm pointing to here is not solarity, but animism. The belief among indigenous people that all things are alive. All things are bearers of sacred personhood. All things have the capacity for being in relationship with others. All of us are people in a certain sense, only some of us are human people. The peeper people, the rock people, the bird people, the tree people, the human people as well. This kind of revisionary animism is a more personal, I think, emotionally rich and less gravitational kind of ethic than what Jane Bennett is suggesting. This is a sort of layering on of a kind of nuance to her proposal. My last comment. And as I crossed the street today to come to Union Seminary, a group of us were walking over, and I saw the watchwords over the entryway to Jewish Theological Seminary. I don't have the exact quote down, but the sort of archway statement was something to the effect of, it burns, but it's not consumed. And it's a reference to the idea of the burning bush in the Hebrew Bible. That stayed aflame perpetually, catalyzed by God's presence, but the flame didn't consume the bush. And Emmanuel Levinas says this should be our disposition towards all others. That we're a light and a fire with a burning, excessive, extravagant, boundless desire for the welfare of all others. And that incessant burning in the hearts of each of us is what continues to motivate and drive us towards justice and compassion for others. And it's that phenomenon of being aflame with desire for others that to me is at the heart of what Jane Bennett calls a kind of interstitial solarity that I want to push on a little bit and suggest that that experience is more passion-ridden and affective than at least in her language what she might suggest. Thank you very much for your attention.
Jane, do you want to respond before we turn to questions, or do you want the response to emerge over the course of the questions?
I can say one beginner thing. You can get to a similar place by many routes, R-O-U-T-E-S, and one way to do it is sort of this animism of universalizing subjectivity. And the path that I could go that way sometimes, but the experiment that I did with the vibrant matter idea was to enter from the other side, which was to exaggerate even, but also the exaggeration would let you notice the vibrancy and the fabulousness of the non-subjective, mm-hmm. of the objective or the thingly, as I called it. So there's two. But they both have this effect of sort of trying to level out the hierarchy. So that part there. But then there's a difference. And the difference is that it depends on what you mean by person and personal. Because I've come more and more to, I don't deny that what it means to be a self, let's just call it like the generic word would be a self, that there's love and there's emotions and there's hate and there's all that stuff. But I also want to emphasize that there's a strata of self, that is not personal. That is apersonal, that is it-like, that is mineral, is, you know, or whatever metaphor or real, you know, or thing that you want to name that is like far from having an interiority of that goes with subjectivity and a capacity for moral judgment, whatever you want to name that thing, let's just call it itness. That there's that too in me. There's a I'm moved by gravitational forces. And I've got calciums doing stuff. And why do I insist that self isn't just, see, I think yours is more the nice and lovey one. And mine has got the more blood in it. Because of the emphasis on the person, you have a model of person. I have a model of person that has a lot of amoral indifference in it, in the way that gravity doesn't care if a good person or a bad person falls off the cliff. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So anyway, I think that there's a really interesting conversation to be had about what is the description, because nobody knows what the self is or what the human, you know, or what you know, what does, so just let's put it to the level of the description. What is the rhetorical effect of the description of the self that you give, that I give, that anyone gives? And what is the sort of political impact of that description? And maybe you could convince me that the political impact or the ethical impact of my account of the self that gives a stronger accent to the apersonal it is going to be, that is going to cause harm. I don't want that, mm-hmm. you know. And if you could convince me of that, then I'll retract the story, mm-hmm. you know, or I'll pursue a different story. Mm-hmm. But I'm going on an intuition that maybe it's better to acknowledge that as constitutive of my very selfhood. Yeah, that's my word. That's not more than a second. Sorry.
I wonder if I could bring both your discourses into various religious scenes. I mentioned this to Jane before we got going, but when I read her paper and heard this notion of waiting and pausing and loafing, the religious episode that came to mind is the episode in the New Testament where the woman is caught in adultery and she's brought before Jesus, and her accusers say, you know, our law requires us to stone her. What should be done with her? And you will remember that Jesus loafs. He doodles on the ground. And we're never told what he does in the dust. But there is a kind of sacred non-judging. And out of that comes a profoundly non-judgmental statement. In which Jesus says to his accusers, he who is without sin, cast the first stone. And that episode for me, I think, captures a great deal of what I think you're trying to articulate, because it's in that pause that a certain kind of new possibility emerges that might be called ethical, but it's not quite ethical, is it? Because Jesus is not wanting to speak of a narrow canonical code-based mode of ethics, but a kind of possibility emerges of a kind of non-judgmental setting and free.
I that's very helpful to me. I like that example. And my sense of that would be that, I mean, you would have to suspend the idea of the divinity of Jesus, but let's just temporarily suspend that. And then you would say, what's going on there? is he's waiting for the scene to change, because there's so much more there's the atmosphere of the setting. It's the wind, it's the gravitational, it's the sweat. It's this, he's waiting for something to change that he's not in control of. And that's the apersonal for me, and that's what the hover does, or the occupation of the interval, is you wait, and then your will can you wait until you like subtly sense that the time can, for something else might have emerged. But you didn't do that. Yeah. Anyway, that's how I would read that.
Questions?
Hi, thank you so much. I really appreciate your articulation of sort of Whitman's solar judgment. I was wondering, you know, how you square that with sort of an ethic of urgency that, you know, scientists tell us we have a decade to make the kinds of, you know, changes that we need to prevent mass extinction, or, you know, even more pressingly, you know, just daily political and injustice and grievous harm being, you know, committed to all sorts of people. How do you, you know, square that reservation of judgment, or, you know, judgment falling like a sun on many things, with the urgency to act in the time frame that we need to act within?
Yeah, you can make bad judgments, which could make things worse. And what I end up taking from Whitman is that this is one component in a more complex repertoire of techniques that you would use for action. But you need to have within your repertoire of action the capacity, the skill, the cultivated capacity to hover in the interval. You don't use it all the time. It's not your only technique. That would be silly. The other thing, and I hear what you're saying, because this is based on a political judgment or a political diagnosis about what the current scene can tolerate right now. And your judgment might be that emphasizing the moment of the hover is the last thing in the world we need now. My sense is that it's not. And that someone mentioned earlier I don't know if she's here, about, 9/11, the Twin Towers, there was a urgent need to act, and then we're still living out I tend to think of this as a useful item in your bag of tricks, and that it's one that in my small subculture world, which is more of a calling out culture, accusatory kind of thing, and judging even on side, that part would be a helpful little nudge. So it isn't actually squarable with the urgency. It's not squarable. It's anti-urgency, but it might make the character of the urgent act slightly different once it's made.
And it seems to me this is what any contemplative tradition does. This is just what it means to do Zen, right? Which is to cultivate the middle space, which is, phenomenologically speaking, a kind of falling open in fullness to the content of the world prior to discriminating judgment, and to thereby create with it a kind of intimacy that capacitates skillful action. So, there are entire contemplative traditions dedicated to the formation of the sacred pause. So, at least in religious context, this should hardly be news.
Right. I wanted to echo this sensibility quickly. John mentioned that you were struck reading Jane's work as a theologian in relation to the story of Jesus and the woman caught in adultery and the pause as he scribbled in the sand. And I was struck as I was reading your work with the primary inaugural image of creation in the Hebrew Bible, where God, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and the Spirit of God hovered over the face of the deep. And the Hebrew word there is, the verb is merachefet, and it describes what a mother bird does over her nest. And I've always pondered over that. Biblical scholar, theological types, that's what we obsess about. But I've often thought, why did the author say that? Wouldn't you want a monarchical, directive, patriarchal God to simply, boom, create everything and it's just done? God creates the heaven and the earth, and the Spirit of God hovers over the face of the deep. It's a maternal image. It's a motherly image. It's an image of pause and nurture and cultivation of the well-being of her young, as if the earth itself is a great egg and God, as a mother bird, is hovering over that great cosmic egg. And the same image is used at the time of Jesus' baptism. The same mothering image, avian image, appears throughout all four Gospels. Jesus is baptized, and the Spirit of God hovers over him. And it seems deeply resonant with what you were trying to say, that there are these moments in these sacred texts of even the divine life itself slowing down and hovering and putting a brake on feverish activity, creating the world. The Son of God gets baptized to open up space for other possibilities.
Ian?
Hi, I'm a student here in the Buddhist program, and Dr. T kind of stole my fire a little bit, but
Non-fire.
I really did notice some, you know, happy congruence between some of what you were saying and things like the 12-fold chain of dependent origination, which is kind of outlines how suffering comes about. But there's a node in that chain between sensation or feeling tone, and the next one is craving. And the practice is, you know, to cultivate an interval. Maybe not loafing, but a deliberate cultivation of an interval between that affect tone, whether it's positive or negative, pleasant or unpleasant, or neutral, which we might not even notice, and the immediate kind of a karmic reaction to that. So that really felt like, and that interval, of course, has ontological and ethical implications.
And this is in the context of
I don't know your reference, but this is in the context of advice or wisdom for action, or
well, this is actually one of the one of the core teachings of what the Buddha realized on this on
I see.
You know, the night of his enlightenment was realizing this. This pattern of causation, and how, and there are kind of two places to interrupt that chain, one of those is in between affect tone and the craving that immediately follows.
And what is the other place, Ian?
At ignorance, you know, the ignorance of our, or not realizing our connection.
Thank you.
So thank you.
John and then David.
I've been told we're going to take one more question and then conclude, if that's all right.
Thank you, Todd. I take everyone else's time here. I'm so sorry. I'm also a student here. And I noted in Dr. Wallace's summary of vibrant matter that it demolishes human chauvinism and what through the book is referred to as anthropocentrism. And I'm so glad that you rose to the challenge of the political affect of things that you may be saying, because there is the question, is it so, is it true, or what is its effect? And of course, anthropocentrism has been linked to so much of the harm that we are now dealing with, and about which you've heard real urgency amongst the students of Dr. Tatominal. We do think a lot about the political aspect, the time associated with it. One of the ways of demolishing this human chauvinism is to deal with hierarchy. And so we have the, you know, sky god or whatever up there, and we kind of come down and we have the patriarchy and females and we work our way down. And of course, the idea has been to undermine a number of those things. One of them in the book Vibrant Matter, though, that you highlight is a distinction between the sort of other than human world on the one hand, and what you call ensouled matter on the other. When I think about the political affect of that, I think about 1.7 billion Muslims and 2.3 billion Christians. And I'm thinking of all of what we need to accomplish, as we say, in the next 11 years, that's a construct that we use. What we mean is really, really, really fast. How would you respond to the challenge that the bar that you're setting is for 5.5 odd billion humans just to come around to the fact that they don't have any souls that they thought they once did.
Okay.
In the next 11 years.
It's a great question. It's a question of audience. I mean, you're vastly overestimating my power. I did not intend that book to be a kind of political manifesto. I intended it to be an exploration for atheists of a motive enchantment with the world. Like, that's what I intended it to be. If you're a believer, there's a more well-established mode of enchantment. I mean, enchantment for me is absolutely indispensable, and it's maybe like the sacred. I mean, you know, it's a very good thing. And that book was like, is there an avenue open that I could try to take a few more steps down for atheists to think about the wondrous quality of the world and to induce in their sensibility, my sensibility, more of what people who are believers already are fortunate enough to have. Or there's traditions for it, talking it in that, you know, there's traditions of caretakership for the earth and of stewardship that are in a religious contexts. But that book was more like, is there an analogous, you know, another path that could make, you know, make overlaps with the religious path here, there, and everywhere, but it was not itself such a thing about the insult. So I was trying to kind of conceptually parse out a space for what I call, you know, like an enchanted understanding of the universe that loves it, that can not be so destructive of it, but that didn't come from a religious root. That's the thing. But I agree with you. If I were to be like going to a climate change march, I would never talk about vibrant matter. You know, I mean, I might. It would depend. I would do a selective version of it to the extent that I don't even like to talk in public. But, you know, if I were to do that, it's all a question for me about your choice of your rhetoric, your identification of who's the audience and what you're trying to do in that moment. So, I hear what you're saying. Yeah, I didn't mean it to be a repudiation of ensouled matter. I just meant it to be an alternative to it that might have some of the laudable ethical effects that the ensouled matter route has had.
Well, I know that we've just begun a conversation. Some of us get to continue it tomorrow in our little colloquium. But I suspect that others of you will continue this conversation in various ways as you leave. We're immensely grateful to you for being here with us, and thank you for your presence and your lively questions. And a special thanks to all the people who are making both this evening and the colloquium happen. Winfield Goodwin, Shana Kaplanoff, Todd Willison, Kate San, I think, is not here. And of course, we must thank Mary, who makes this entire series possible. And last but not least, our lively interlocutors for today, Jane and Mark. Thank you all.
My mind is very strong.
Yes, I can tell. I can tell.
I would like to go more. Maybe I'll press.
Yeah.
You
know,
they have a sense of what audience is going to hear.
No, I thought that was my name. They were consistent.
That's right.
So they're going to take us to a bar. Oh, that's wonderful.
Have one drink on the project, and then
more vibrant manner.
More vibrant.
Yeah, I like that. God, this has been wonderful. You've been very hospitable. And